Yeah, dude. One more chance. One more podcast. Yo, listen. Shout out to everybody tuning in right now. You know it is, the highest host, Adam Hill, right here at Hayes Radio for another edition of the podcast, baby. Yeah. This is where applause happens. Everyone cheers. Woo! There's fireworks. Pyros go off. Kyntron, of course, chilling out here, tickling them ebonies and ivories. At the live, how you feeling, Ken? How you doing? How's everything with you, man?
Oh, man, it's great when I get out of traffic. That's but, you know, at least my car is comfortable. It's not like a bad car to be inside of, so it's not too bad. So all you road rangers, chill out.
Just chill, dude.
Enjoy your car.
Chill, dude. Would you, if you had autopilot, if you could just put in the destination like some cars have today, and just put in the address and sit back and just let the car drive, would you let it?
I don't know if I could do that, man. I mean, I'll be too scared.
You don't trust it yet?
No.
Don't trust the technology? What if it was a transformer? What if, like, Optimus Prime said, Kyntron, roll out.
There has to be a remote control somewhere.
You would trust Optimus Prime?
On hand. It has to be some way that I can take over at some point.
You can, I think.
You know, I'll let it do its thing. You know, if I start seeing it kind of drift into danger, yeah.
Okay. I get it. You're not used to it yet. But speaking of self-driving cars, and I know Teslas have that, this pusher sitting next to me right here, dude, who I want to welcome, who actually, you know, did what a lot of people wish they could do in the space and has come through the cannabis community and provided a service that people needed. And then some company was like, you know what, dog, we like this shit, let's make it happen, we're gonna take it. And he's like, no problem, I want to travel the world and do comedy anyway. And he's sitting right here, we're gonna learn all about it. I'm talking about my boy Harrison Baum, baby.
Hell yeah, thank you for having me.
Hell yeah,
you make it sound so elegant.
What do you mean, dude? That's real life.
Yeah. It's like my baby, and then it's like you're selling your child to someone else you never met, and they're in Canada. But it's cool. It like worked out. It was great. But it was like, it was bittersweet. You know, it's like something that I've had for 7 years.
I'm talking about the Daily High Club. If y'all are wondering, Harrison created the Daily High Club, which is a subscription service for basic consumption products.
Yeah.
More or less, like accessories.
I like how you implied, like, I invented Tesla. You're like, speaking of self-driving, this guy has a product.
Well, I know you. No, I know you have a Tesla. You're like super hyped about your Tesla.
I invented Tesla.
Hey, look. Listen, handle it.
You're welcome.
There's a shortage, but you know, those batteries cause a lot of damage to the earth, dude.
Yeah, dude. That's what I was saying, but you guys stole my idea.
Do you like your Tesla? You got one, right?
Yeah, I do like it.
Yeah? Is it self-driving?
Yeah,
Have you used that feature yet?
I use it all the time. It's fucking great. That's how I got here.
Yeah? See? He uses self-driving. Ken's like, nah, I'm still driving on my own, dude.
Yo, if you saw me drive, you'd be like, yo, turn on the self-driving.
I have to see it happen in real life. I haven't even been inside of a Tesla, so I don't have any ideas. Like, I see him all the time.
You never
see how fast they can go. Like, all of a sudden, I'll see a Tesla just... Like, it'll start off slow, but then it'll go super fast because my car is slow. So I see him out there, man.
Yeah, the plaids are pretty fast. Ain't that like 1,000 horsepower or something? Yeah. Something unnecessary.
It's crazy.
Yeah, but we're getting it, dude. So, anyways, Harrison, thank you for coming. I know this is a long time waiting. We've been talking about this for a minute.
Yeah.
And you're here, dude.
Yeah.
Making it happen.
Yeah.
I got to hang out with you the other day. We had some tacos on the beach. Heard some interesting conversations.
That was a conversation.
Heard some, okay, well, people and their opinions. It's cool, dude. Sometimes just keep it. But how you doing, dude? Everything all right in life? How's everything going with you right now?
Yeah, it's good. I'm just like kind of, it's weird. Like I just left the LA High Club. So it's been 7 years. It's pretty bittersweet. And now I'm like, I wake up, I'm just like, wait, what do I do? Like, what the fuck do I do? So I'm trying to figure that out. I've been doing the comedy, which has been going really well. But that doesn't seem like it's like a thing where you get money for a long time. So like, I'm starting to consult for people, and I have a bunch of other business ideas that I'm thinking of doing, but just kind of too burnt out right now.
Enjoying what's going on right now. So for those of you, so Daily High Club, this one you said 7 years.
Yeah.
And you started, how did you come up with the idea? What made you think of it? How did you want to do it?
Yeah, so, there's a part of the story that is, it started off as a different business. I don't want to tell what that business is because I might do it soon, but I'll tell you in a little bit. But yeah, I saw that there were smoking subscription boxes out there, and I actually saw one on Facebook, and I saw I was working on my own subscription service, and I saw the Dankstop AMA on Reddit, and I saw on Facebook Hemper was like running ads and shit, and I was like, wait, this is cannabis, this is online head shops, Dankstop, this is killing it. There's cannabis subscription boxes like Hemper and Cannabox and shit like that that's killing it. And I'm like, but the best subscription ever was Dollar Shave Club, and no one's done this for a dollar. So I started it as Dollar High Club. So it was originally a wholesome family subscription I was working on for something else. And then I'm like, wait, weed would be so much better, and I like this so much more. So I went on Reddit and I'm like, yo, I have this idea. For a dollar, you can get rolling papers every month, Hempwick matches, all you need to roll a J a day. And people love the idea on Reddit. So I got my first 200 subscribers overnight. There's another.
For a dollar.
For actually, most people signed up for the $12 package. For a dollar, a $12, and a $30 package.
Okay.
What's interesting is I thought everyone would want the dollar. Everyone signed up for the $12. And then now, like, over 90% of our sales are the $30.
What? And it was just different packages? Like, the dollars, like, papers, wicks, whatever. The $12 is what, like, a lighter, a pipe or something?
Yeah, it was, like, made for rollers. But, like, we kind of phased it out because we just, like, weren't making enough money with it. And we're just like, why don't we push people towards the $30 one? And then we kind of grew from there and as an online head shop. So, like, yeah, we were number one on Google for bong for a couple years. We might still be now. I know we're in the top few. And, yeah, we just try to come out with unique bongs every month. And it's been fucking awesome, but a lot of work.
So it wasn't weed in the beginning that you were after. You were doing another type of box.
Yeah, I was doing a different box.
And you were, and you had a passion for cannabis, or you just like were?
I did have a passion for cannabis.
Did you have like a situation where you ran out of papers or a pipe, and you're like, oh, I just wish I could have something delivered to me?
Yeah, I actually have a picture of the receipt on my phone still. I went to a head shop, rolling papers, lighter, filter tips, $7.50 including tax.
And you're like, what?
I was like, what the fuck? Like, I could get this shit so much cheaper. Like, you could buy shit from Raw in bulk for, like, their papers are, I don't know if they want me saying their pricing, but I'll say it's under a dollar. And, like,
yeah
well, there's no reason bulk, to be paying five fucking dollars at a store. Someone could sell them for under a dollar and just
still make provide, it happen,
make
yeah.
it easy, yeah.
Because when you're buying bulk or wholesale, it's a lot different than retail.
Yeah.
And sometimes you can get access to that, and a lot of people may not know. But, like, that's how Costco is, you know? Costco is, like, that bulk buying, and you get it for a certain price. And there's ways to do that within our community as well. And, you know, you were like, yo, I could get this and help a lot of people out instead of just myself. Look at you. You're such a nice guy. Were you always a nice guy?
I feel like I was too nice in the beginning.
Too nice?
Yeah.
Like, but I'm just talking about in life, like in school. Were you like the nice kid in school? How were you as a kid growing up? Where'd you grow up?
I grew up in Maryland.
Okay, East Coast?
Yeah, like Gaithersburg, Maryland.
Okay.
So, kind of near Logic and Dave Chappelle, which is pretty sweet. That's about it for famous people from my area. Like, pretty dope. It's like, we got two, so we don't have like cool that LA spread, but... We got Logic and Dave Chappelle.
Right.
So I saw Wolf Blitzer on the street once. That was my only celebrity encounter ever till I came to LA. I'd never been west of West Virginia.
Was Wolf Blitzer considered a celebrity sighting?
He's he like was a news at the anchor, time. Right? Yeah, don't diminish this. This is the only one for fucking 27 years.
So you grew up in Maryland. You were a good student.
No, I was a terrible student.
Were you?
I failed chemistry, health class, calculus. Like a bunch of other stuff.
Because you were just didn't want to do it, or because you just didn't get it? What do you mean you fit
like both? It was like I didn't want to do it. I didn't get it. It was super hard. Even in first grade, I was just like, oh my god, how's everyone like doing shit so fast? And it was just like I was never like really on the ball in school. I did okay in college. I had like a C+ average. I definitely worked a bit harder, but in high school I was just kind of lost, had no motivation. I really liked like English and tech, but I didn't do like particularly great in them.
Would think someone who just like created a company and was able to sell it for millions was like a good student on top of shit, and you're like, nah dog, I was like not good in school, I didn't get shit, but you know, I was able to form a company and make shit happen, dude.
So it's really like feel like what you get taught in school with classes that you don't want to learn about and you're not there to learn about is like almost a different part of your brain when you're doing something that you want to do that you're passionate about. Like, weed was legalized in DC in 2014, which was like one of the earliest in the country, and I think you could have like up to 8 plants there. And I was just like, holy shit, I live a mile from this place, yeah. And weed is legal. Like, I gotta find a way to get into this because I was working in customer service at Vistaprint, and
so that must have been exciting, just making a bunch of business cards for random people.
It was like, it was more like people were like, hey, my cards and shit are fucked up, and they would like come to me and I'd just like deal with it.
Oh, customer service is horrible.
Yeah, it was humbling.
Y'all fucked up my $5 order of business cards. Yeah. I want a refund.
But, and before that, I sold floor mats on the phone. And before that, I fixed iPhones in college.
Whoa!
Yeah, that's how I paid my tuition, but it didn't, like, translate into, like...
Like, when you fixed iPhones, were you, like, this middle-of-the-mall kiosk type of come to me, or were you, like
at my school.
So you would hit up students and, like, yo, I'll fix that screen
for
you.
Yeah, Facebook ads.
Like, what?
Yeah, so that was, like... That, like, it didn't help me, like, in any practical way after college immediately, but it was the beginning of, like, it was super valuable to me to learn customer service and, like, working with suppliers of, like, fragile glass things that you're importing, like, and,
you were interested. Were you always, like, hustling? Did you always have this, like, business mentality, like, I need to make money? And
yeah, I always wanted to start a business. I sold paper airplanes in elementary
school. Stop it, really? Yeah,
and in high school and college, I did the fixing iPhones thing. And then after college, I was like, I realized I couldn't really scale the fixing iPhones. So I applied for Vistaprint and didn't really know what I wanted to do. And I applied for a bunch of jobs for a while, and I finally got the Vistaprint job. And then I'm like, screw it, I'm starting a business. I started to work on that other idea. And then I realized, oh my God, why am I not doing weed? Like, at first it felt like, since there are companies like Dankstop that was already like really dominant in the space, so it felt like, oh, all these companies are too big for me to even get into this. And for like a month I didn't like start it or do anything with it until I realized, like, oh my God, I could do it different for a dollar. And then from that moment it was just nonstop working right. on it.
R&D, figuring things out. I want to go back though. Paper airplanes in elementary school, like, what were we selling, like a dollar a plane or? And what was it, like different folds?
It was like 25 cents a plane.
And you had different versions, like this, you could get this version or this version?
Yeah. So we got them ready to sell. My friend's mom bought them all. So like I got cleaned out and I was like, fuck yeah.
Your friend's mom?
Yeah, she bought them all.
How many did you make?
We made like 75 of them.
And she bought them all for, what's the math on that, dude? That's a lot for a little elementary.
Like 25 cents. And I split it with my friend, too. He's helping roll. So, not roll.
You're on fold. You fold. Dang. And kids were like, let me buy it. They didn't want to learn how to fold an airplane. They're just like...
I mean, we honestly never got to the school. His mom bought them all. But we were like ready to sell them at school.
You were ready. It was a business plan.
I was like, this is $12. That's a business. Mm-hmm. I think that's the math on like 75 times 25.
Yeah, 25, that's what I was trying to do,
something like that, yeah.
My brain hurts right now, so I wasn't really trying to get all that math in.
It was like fifth grader money. Like, it was adult shit.
So what made you want to just get the money? Did you have anything? Why were you just after money and business? Did you have siblings? Are you a...
Yeah, I have a sister. She was a Fed for a while. So that made things like really awkward. But she's more on like the anti-terrorist side, not the like anti-weed side.
Yeah.
But
you weren't doing anything illegal. You're just doing, like, I guess, is it considered paraphernalia? Or is your family like cool with you with this?
My family doesn't smoke weed.
When they knew you were selling like bongs and things, were they like, Harrison?
At first they were like, don't do this. And I'm like, I'm going to do this. And then they, I will say, they like pretty quickly went from like, don't do this to like, okay, we're proud. He's actually like... He's selling a bunch.
They saw the success and they're like, all right.
Yeah.
When was your first experience with cannabis? Because you said your family doesn't smoke it at all. And you got your older sister, I'm guessing, is a fed?
Younger sister.
She's younger?
Yeah.
Damn.
She's never touched weed. Probably not going to.
Well, I mean, yeah, it's her job. So how did you get to, like, what was your first experience?
Yeah, so the first time I tried it was right after high school. I feel like, which is, like, the latest of, like, anyone I've met in the cannabis industry. But, like, in high school, I was brainwashed. I thought it was bad, like, as if my grades could get any worse. But, like, Yeah, I thought it was bad, and I didn't do it, and I didn't drink, I didn't smoke, and then after high school, I hit my friend's bowl, and I, like, swore that it did not work, and then the next morning, he's like, yo, you ate all of those, like, Snackwell cookies, and you dipped them in all of our garlic sauce, so I'm like, wow, I probably, like, won't do that, so I guess I was, like, super stoned. I just remember, like, hitting it over and over and over on the deck. I'm just like, I don't know if this is working, but it was, like, totally working, and then like access was like really hard to get, so I didn't get it again.
Even though it was legal in DC,
no, it wasn't at that point. Okay. Yeah, like I have friends with felonies for it. Like, you have to be like super fucking on the down low, because like, yeah, you'll fucking get your life ruined.
So you smoked a pipe your first time, glass pipe.
Yeah, a bowl.
Bowls, and you ate cookies inside garlic sauce.
Yeah.
And you don't remember.
I like kind of remember. At the time, I was like, this seems like a good idea, and like it seemed like it tasted like it was good.
Well, sometimes the best inventions come when you're high. Like, yeah. You mix foods.
Maybe
together.
I should revisit that. It's probably a bad idea, but.
No, I do it sometimes. I mean, I do it live on stream sometimes where I'll mix munchies and I'll like try two different things. I'm like, yo, this is amazing.
Yeah.
I'm trying to remember what I did the last time. I had like a banana, like a real banana, and I think it was like a stroop waffle. And I just like think I ate them together and I was like, yo, this is like the best fresh preservative like snack I think I've had in a minute.
Yeah.
Next time I kick keys. Because a Kit Key is...
What's a Kit Key?
A Kit Key is when I take a Twinkie and a Kit Kat.
Oh!
And I take the Kit Kat and I shove it inside the Twinkie. Oh. And I get like that chocolatey, crispy, crunchy,
damn. Did
creamy.
You make that up?
Yeah.
Holy shit.
Like maybe like 8 some years ago. Yeah, it's amazing.
You should get a utility patent.
What? Kit Keys? Is that possible?
I don't know.
Yeah. I also like making little cheeseburgers. I take Cheez-Its and beef jerky. Mm-hmm. And I take the two Cheez-Its and put beef jerky in the middle. It's like a little... bite-sized to-go burger.
Damn, that's good.
Yeah, yeah. I'm a munchie king, dude.
Yeah.
Do you have a go-to munchie?
Go-to munchie.
Like, when you get the munchies. I know you're not dipping cookies in garlic sauce all the time.
Yeah, I do love cookies. I eat a lot of fucking cookies. Like, way too many cookies, honestly.
Like snickerdoodle, chocolate chip.
Like, chocolate chip. Like, you know those, like, fucking... vegan Lenny Larry cookies.
Yes.
Like they make you think they're like kind of healthy because it says complete on it, but I eat like 2 to 3 of those a day. It's super bad. I love Swedish fish. I love kettle corn.
Do you really love Swedish fish?
You're
like the second
Swedish
person
fish?
I met recently that like was, I'm like, who eats Swedish fish regularly?
Oh,
that's like the Halloween candy you get. You're like, oh, I guess I'll eat Swedish fish,
dude. Give them to me. I'm all about it.
Oh,
fucking,
yeah.
But all the other shit, Snickers, Butterfingers, dude, I fucking love candy.
Candy. So you like sweet. You go for sweet. Peppers.
Yeah.
All right. All right.
What about you?
My go-to, I usually, like, the easiest go-to for me is, like, chips. Like, I'll go for, like, a bag of chips. You know, preferably, like, some spicy chips. Like a jalapeno or a Flamin' Hot or something. Because that's always easy. But if I'm getting, like, creative, then it just depends.
Have you done the one chip challenge?
I've hosted some events where they did it, but I've never eaten it. Because I like spicy food that's appetizing it and it's delicious.
It's not appetizing.
I don't like
delicious.
Spicy that hurts you and doesn't taste. Because my friends explained it like it's eating hot asphalt. Like it tastes like dirt. You tried it?
Yeah.
What did it taste like?
It was awful. I mean, I didn't really. I just like swallowed it as quick as possible.
Oof.
And then
butthole
I like
burns.
Vomited a bunch and butthole burn was like a day later.
Yeah.
So like it came in waves.
So it wasn't fun.
It wasn't fun. It was in no way worth it.
Did you beat the challenge though? Did you not drink for whatever it is? 3 minutes or 5 minutes?
I guess. I beat it. Like, I'm not the cast because I threw it up.
I blocked
so,
out.
Yeah.
I blocked out. I remember. So you so the first time you smoked was already out of high school. Were you still with your parents or were you in college already?
I was with my parents,
Did they know that you smoked or?
No, they didn't know.
No?
Yeah.
And you hit it, you're like, I'm not letting them know these.
Yeah, no. They don't smoke or drink.
So. Did they ever catch you smoking weed or did they only find out once you started the weed business?
They've never like caught me and confronted it. Like I'm wondering if they like knew and didn't say anything, but like, yeah.
Because I guess you were, like, a good kid, right? I guess you weren't, like, really... Were you a rebel? Were you, like...
I was kind of, like, a rebel kid. Like, but, like, I was pretty quiet. Like,
a rebel kid, like, I'm just gonna go chill in my room and play video games? Or, like, I'm just gonna go out and play on the streets?
I played a lot of video games. Sometimes I would, like, start food fights.
What do you mean? At school?
Yeah.
You just throw a meatball
just
at someone?
Just take a yogurt and then it's on, dude. Like, I kind of regret that. That was a dick move.
Hold on, you just randomly, like, you know what? I just want to throw this show. And you just threw it randomly in the air.
Yeah.
Not at any
I was, like, bullied a lot, so I was just, like, I had to get that rage out. And this kid would always steal my lunch, so sometimes I would, like, get ahead of it and just preemptively, like, smack him with the sandwich. So, like, it was, dude, middle school was a tough time.
Wait, so you had a bully.
Yeah.
And you would throw your food at him.
Yeah, or else he was going to eat it. Because
he was going to take it, so you know what? Yeah. You're not going to eat
and
it.
And then
I
started to like become the monster of actually starting the fights, even when the bully wasn't there.
What? So, like, just because?
Just because, yes.
You had that. It was just the excitement.
It was the rage, yeah.
You're like, let's go. Yeah. This is something to live for.
Yeah, it's like, I'm fucking 12 getting into puberty. Let's fucking throw some sandwiches to people.
So you said a particular moment where you just threw a yogurt in the air. What happened? You just threw it, and then all of a sudden...
Yeah, dude, it hit this girl on the back. I like felt like pretty bad. She wasn't like super involved.
Did everyone point at you, or did everyone just start randomly?
No, dude, I got away with it clean. Like,
just a confession.
Yeah, I don't talk about this often.
Her name was Susie. I'm sorry.
Yeah, sometimes in the middle of the night, I'm just like, whoa, that was a dick move.
Like, I'm just going to throw this yogurt in the air. I don't give a fuck.
But it's happened to me. I'm not going to lie and be like, I've never had some shit just thrown at me at lunch. Like, yeah.
That's pretty interesting. I don't got a lot to do in Maryland, I guess, right?
Oh, no, man. You're like, I should have started smoking weed, dude.
I got excited when Wolf Blitzer walked by. What you think?
That was a big moment.
What you think, dude? All right, so here you are, East Coast. You know, you just chilling in school, doing whatever. Smoke weed after high school.
Yeah.
And then you're working these jobs. You're like, fuck this shit. Like, I need my own thing. I'm tired of spending. I spent $7 on a lighter and papers. This is ridiculous, dude. I need to figure this out. And then you start researching. You start sourcing products.
Yeah.
You start a subscription box. You get, I remember, I seeing you, I think the first time, my first experience might be different from your first experience, but I think the first time I seen you was at the Green Street building on Wilshire?
Yeah. We had an office there in the, like, side area.
Yeah, on the bottom area. Yeah, and I would come in every once in a while to say what's up, because I knew a couple people there, and I saw you guys just growing and grinding and working it out. And you're just building subscriptions. And I think I read something like 15,000 subscribers or 30,000 subscribers. What was it?
Yeah, it's been over 15,000.
15,000 monthly subscribers.
And we've shipped out over 1 million boxes. So.
1 million boxes.
Yeah, hell yeah.
Yo, that's huge.
Yeah,
dude.
Big thanks to the Daily High Club team for helping make that happen. It was a fucking lot of boxes, a lot of...
And how has that process been? I'm sure you learned so much with, like, glass and the different quality and where it comes from and which countries and how they weld it together.
Oh, yeah.
And the different quality of papers and lighters and gas and hemp wicks and all sorts of crazy things. Yeah?
Yeah.
What's like the biggest thing you gained from it?
The biggest thing I've gained, so...
From learning all this, because I know a lot of people have questions. People are like, American glass or China glass, who smokes out of China? But not realizing a lot of the technology they smoke out of is China.
Yeah,
what?
Your phone that you're like bitching at on, like, look at what you're typing on. You're typing on China glass.
Yo, that electric rig that you're hyped about, that you spent hundreds of dollars on, it's made in China.
Yeah.
And you're complaining about this glass that was super affordable, and if it breaks, I don't give a fuck.
Yeah.
Like, what? What are we talking about here?
No, but huge shout-outs to, like, the American artists who really, like, paved the way. Like, I have massive respect for them, but the reality is not everyone is going to spend $100 on a piece. And as much as I...
$1,000, $5,000. Like, I've seen rigs go sell for, like, $100,000.
Yeah. And, like, I'm that person who, like... I don't want an expensive piece because I've broken so many fucking pieces.
That part.
Yeah, like, actually, it would be cool to have an expensive piece, but it goes on a shelf and I don't fucking use it. Like, but, yeah, and I have, like two pieces that I, like, really, really treasure that, like, I never use, but, like...
Which one is it?
One of them is the Tommy Chong's 80th birthday and, like, signed by him. And the other one is...
That's the one you guys made?
Yeah.
Okay, yeah. So your collab with Tommy Chong.
Yeah.
How was that moment in your life? Like,
that was a dream come true, man. That was really unbelievable. Like, and we shared that office with him for a year and a half. So like I got to see him a lot doing this thing, and he's just like a super genuine, hilarious person. Like,
cause I've seen like on the socials, there's a lot of pictures of you with many celebrities. You worked with a lot of celebrities. You've gotten a lot of celebrities high. Is there like, I know Tommy Chong is one. Has there been like an oh shit moment where you're like, yo, I can't believe like I'm chilling with Snoop Dogg on set, like sponsoring his main game thing, or I'm
yeah, that was like super surreal. It's just like he's just chilling there, like at his desk playing video games, and like I remember someone we like it was like super chaotic because we were like trying to like organize having our booth or whatever at the event, and like having people wear pieces, and we wanted to give Snoop Dogg a piece, and so we gave him a box, and I realized that we gave him the eggplant, which was like,
oh no,
kind of like a dick emoji. Yeah. And I'm like, oh fuck, like I doubt Snoop Dogg ever even like uses bombs. Yeah. Or whatever, but I'm just like, oh shit. And then like Snoop like got up to go to the bathroom or something, and I like went to his desk and like
switched it out.
That was like one of the scariest moments in my life. Like, what if Snoop Dogg sees me going to his desk, fucking switching this out with a dank tank?
Like, you should have just left him out with the eggplant. Just, he probably would have commented on that even more. Like,
yeah,
like,
maybe I should have left the eggplant.
He was
yeah.
like, what the fuck is this? Yeah, tweeted about that shit.
But dude, I will say the eggplant actually, that was one of my biggest lessons in the history of the business, because it's like, that was a fucking disaster. Like, I don't know if you know the extent of what happened with that.
No, what happened? Because I remember you guys were doing this, like, every month. So if you guys aren't familiar with Daily High Club, they would curate these boxes every month. And they would have different themed boxes.
Yeah.
Correct me if I'm wrong or wherever I fuck up. But they would have themed boxes. And sometimes they would have, like, they would collab with different artists, collab with different celebrities. And they would take, like, user or like, user requests and, like, have fans submit ideas. And one time you guys had the eggplant, which was like the super penis emoji. Did you know eggplant is a fruit?
No, I didn't know that.
Eggplant's a fruit, just so you know.
Wow.
Anyway, so you guys had the eggplant.
Yeah.
And what was wrong with that? What happened? I thought it was a success.
So we lost like a third of our subscribers overnight. Like, and then we lost like way more over the course of the month. People were just mass canceling. It was a very similar response to that guy last night who was ranting at the
oh, yeah.
Like, people were just like, oh, I'm not fucking they're sucking just... that dick. It's like, it's not a dick. It's an eggplant. It's not an eggplant. It's a bong, and you don't suck it. It's fucking, I've just seen so
just a lot of anti.
Yeah, like... and it's like, oh my God, we have thousands of fucking eggplant pipes, and we're not even going to be able to pay our vendor because we don't make, like, anything on these boxes.
Right.
We're just, like, trying to grow the business. And, like, I really thought we were going to go out of business because we, like, made such a bad call at that eggplant bomb. So that was an absolute nightmare. Super scary. We, yeah, like, crippled us for a while. Like, our ability to market and
people
bring
just,
on new
yeah.
influencers and, like... A lot of our customer base was really betrayed and canceled, and it really taught me a lot about how you really need to, like, know your customer, and we do constant surveys since, and, like, yeah, we thought it would just be, like, funny, because everyone
were so
California
insecure,
thought it was funny.
And, but, yeah, the rest of the country didn't like that.
Yeah, a lot of our customers are in the middle of America where it's harder to get
yeah.
a bong, and where they might not be as big fans of eggplants.
Yeah, I didn't put my lips on that eggplant! What do I look? That's crazy though, how like gifted to someone, bro. If you were subscribing, like, I get so, I'm very fortunate and grateful, by the way. Just so, but like, I get, like, I got gifted an iSpire today for doing some shoot. And you know what I did with it? I gave it right to my boy. I said, look, bro, like, I have so many pieces. I have an earring that I enjoy a lot. That I, it's my go-to. Shout out to the Carta 2. That's like my
Hell
go-to
yeah.
earring. And I don't need like a stack of 15 other products. Like, and if
yeah.
I have friends that want one or need one or don't have access to it, like, here, bro, I have enough here. I do giveaways all day on Twitch to get rid of all these products I get.
Yeah.
I get the subscription boxes and I just give them away. I'm like, oh, I could use this yeah. later. Or something. So I'm like, I'll see what's in there. And then I'll just give it, dude. I don't need... I have a box of papers, a box of rolling trays, a box of rigs, a box.
Yeah.
I'm sure you do, too.
Oh, dude, when I lived in D.C., like, my shelf was just like, okay, I have, like, fucking 45 bongs now. Like, it's like, when it was, like, time to move, it was just like, oh, my God, this is, like, not sustainable to have this many bongs. And, yeah, now I limit myself. I have, like, 6 bongs in
yeah.
my apartment. That's not true. I have, like, 10, but, like, 4 of them are packed up. My favorite,
Yeah. And then what do you do with the rest of them?
The other, like,
four. The ones that you didn't want, yeah.
Give them away.
Yeah. See, that's why I want to create, like, a store. Maybe, you know, your next adventure, because we're about to get into the next movies after Daily High Club. I know you're doing comedy now. I know you're thinking of some things, but look, dog, I got some ideas, too. You know?
Oh, yeah.
I was thinking, because I was trying to work this with someone else, but, you know, some things fell through. But there should be, like a secondhand, like, a shop for our community. Like, I have 80 bongs. I don't need them all. And I could just put them on the shelf if someone else wants to buy them. Like you know, people go to, like, Round 2 or those vintage shops where it's, like, a t-shirt from, like, 20 years ago where people are buying old shoes. Like,
yeah.
I have rigs that I don't even smoke anymore. I could just put them at the secondhand store on consignment. And if someone wants to buy them, bam, get that shit. Like, a secondhand.
Yeah, that'd be dope.
Rigs, carb caps, pipes, fucking whatever, rolling trays, grind, whatever you have. Just here, budget, like a pawn shop for your rigs.
Yeah. There's, like, so much shit. Like, I filled my car with, like, a bunch of free shit I got, and, like, when I was, like, leaving the company, and then, like, when the warehouse, I don't know what they're doing with it, but I had to just, like, leave a lot of it, and I'm like, yo, try to get this in, like, a mega box or something to DHT people, because, like, I don't know what to do with all this stuff. Like, yeah.
Yeah, like, what? Let me open up a storefront, and then anyone who wants, like, my piece from 2014 made by some famous artist, pull up.
Yeah.
If you want some, like, a $5 box of rigs, dude, pull up. We got it. Right here for you.
Yeah, hell yeah. That'd be sick.
I'll pull a bunch. I have like 30 rigs right now that I can put on the shelf.
I hate wasting shit. I hate throwing stuff away.
Yeah. So. I know someone will find use for it somewhere, dude. I'm sure someone watching right now is like, damn, give me something.
Yeah.
I tweeted the other day, like, yo, I got so much glass because I cleaned my whole, like, streaming room. Mm-hmm. I got so much glass. Who needs a piece? And, like, so many people responded that needed pieces, and they sent me pictures of their broken rigs, or they sent some sob story about something, of like, oh, my dog broke my rig, and just got too excited. I was like, bro, we're going to figure something out. I'm about to do some type of giveaway, dude. We got a bunch of eggplants. Who wants an eggplant? No, I'm just playing.
I think over time we did end up selling most, if not all, of those. Next, like, 4 years.
And now people will probably go crazy over eggplants.
Yeah, it's like some people really like it, but it was like the majority, or like a big portion of people did not enough that it got fucked up.
Yeah.
It got fucked up.
Yeah. Well, shout out to the success you got with Daily High Club, staying consistent with it, turning, you know, an idea into reality. I know you started in your house, like you said, has boxes and rigs into warehouses, and then now you got acquired by a big company, and you're chilling, traveling the world. And recently, I didn't know if I was getting trolled with, I'm not on Instagram anymore, but when I was on Instagram, I saw someone post a picture like, oh, look, it's Harrison doing his comedy set. And I thought it was just someone looking like you, and they're like, oh, look, it's Harrison. And then I come to find out it actually is you doing actual comedy. And this is something you've always been in. Like, I know you tried to do comedy before.
Yeah, I did it for 2 years in college and was fairly successful with it.
Did you go on like some TV show or something?
I was one of TBS's top 16 college comedians, and I won third at the improv for DC's Funniest College Comedian.
What? How many people entered? That third is a great accomplishment.
For the DC's Funniest one, I think it was like two rounds from like a couple schools in DC, so probably like 40-50 people, but the TBS one was like hundreds of people.
So
that was super dope, and I was on the front of my school's newspaper, and I was like a briefly college celebrity.
How much
at least I like to think.
How much butt did you get after that?
Literally none.
What?
Yeah.
You were on the cover and other girls were like, what's up, Harrison?
Yeah.
And you made them laugh and like, oh, you're so cute. And then you got some cheeks? None?
Yeah, actually maybe one or two.
Okay. Like, you have to get some type of being on the cover. Yeah. Like, what? He said maybe one or two. It's okay. You don't have to lie. It's all right,
Harrison. No, I was in college. I was actually very serious about the iPhone repair to the point where I didn't really like have that college experience of partying and having a lot of fun. And I almost regret it a bit. I was like too serious about working on this thing that at the end of the day didn't really matter that much.
But you did. It helped you out, didn't it? And you learned a little bit. You made some money. It helped you with your tuition. Did you use any of your college education for your Daily High Club business? Did any of it?
Only one thing. The only thing that I use, and I hate to say it because it's just such a boring answer, but fucking Excel. Like, If you're gonna have a business, you have to use so much goddamn Excel. And it was like, I took this one stupid fucking Excel class. Or I guess it wasn't dumb, but I like really hated it. And like, but it like taught me about Excel, and I got like a B or C in it. Yeah, then I found out I'm like gonna be using that shit all of the time.
That's one of the useful things you learn in school that they taught you that you're using now. Not like the, not like what is a, okay, I'm trying to think of all those math terms that we learned. I got one right here, dude. Yeah, like whatever.
Geometry, triangle.
Yeah. Like the, what is
Pythagorean
the...
Pythagorean theorem.
Yeah, 100%. There you go. Like, I still don't know what it is.
No, no one does.
Yeah, but I know I had to learn it. That, they taught that shit to me, dude. So what's going on with the comedy? So you're touring, you performing, you're doing shows. I see you have a show that you're actually going to be throwing.
Yeah, so I'm helping Infuse throw a show on Tuesday the 9th at 9. Doors open at 8 at Infuse Social House, so I'm stoked about that. I got a hand in choosing the lineup, and I chose some really fucking funny comedians. So.
Nice. That's a, so, like, what is Harrison's comedy about? Is it just, like, opinional? Is it observational? Is it...
It's, like, a little bit of both. It's just, like, shit I think of while I'm high. Like, it's, yeah. Like, kind of all over the place and random, but I really want to, like, I really want to come out swinging against, like, injustices in society. So, I don't know if I've quite accomplished that yet, but,
Yeah, because I was looking at your Twitter... And you have some interesting tweets on there.
Wow, you saw my Twitter, man. Yeah, this, I've never gotten more than 3 likes on it. That's my max right now.
Well, I just started it on Twitter again.
Yeah.
By the way, everyone in chat saying how much they use Excel and they use it on a daily basis and all this shit.
Dude, so. Excel's so boring, but it's like...
You use Excel too? Yeah, everyone does, dude. See. So yeah, I was on Twitter and I looked you up. I tagged you in a post too, by the way. I don't know if you saw the flyer or anything. Shout out to Alienation, baby. Thank you, Matt. It said something that you were talking about your dick. You use your dick in a lot of jokes and like your sex life.
Yeah, it's a good one.
It was. I don't want to butcher it, but you're comparing it to like the LA public transit.
Oh yeah, I compared it to the LA Metro.
Yeah,
because it's surprisingly expensive and open to the public, but everyone acts like it doesn't exist. If a homeless person hops on every now and then, it's free country.
Yeah. So yeah, I see somebody. I know you used to have a guitar too. Is that still part of your gig or something?
Yeah, I've actually been like, so people are so fucking like divided over the guitar. It's pretty crazy that like people even give a shit about it so much. Like half the people are like, oh, I fucking love the guitar. It like helps all the one-liners come together. And half the people are like, yo, lose the guitar. And it's like everyone seems to have an opinion on it, and I don't know what to do yet.
So how do you feel?
I feel like it's kind of like when I have a bunch of like, because like my most recent set, it was only like a 5 to 10 minute set, but I had 42 jokes. And it's like for all those one-liners, there's so many and they're so unrelated a lot of the time that to have like the background music, I'm very inspired by like Dimitri Martin.
Yeah.
It's like a very similar thing with a piano and I think a guitar too. And I really think it helps like, It just adds another layer of the mood. Like, it kind of sets a mood. It lets you jump around things more often. It lets you have more space between jokes without having to have as much transitions. So, but I'm still learning and trying to figure out comedy. It is, like, a lot harder and sucks to carry. So, that's mainly why I haven't used it.
I have to plug it in. There's work that goes with it instead of talking to a mic. No, I feel you with music, though. I mean, you know. This podcast is amazing and all, yay! But having Kyntron here...
Dude, fucking next level. I love
with
it.
With the vibe and just going with the conversation and not having to worry about, like, copywritten music and just him... And then, like, when he's really involved and he hears us talking about things and he triggers certain songs or sounds, it just goes with a cool vibe. So, having music along to keep that beat, to keep that flow is amazing, dude. So, I mean, I'll wait to see both with the guitar and without the guitar, and I'll give you my opinion. But it doesn't matter, bro, because you should do what the fuck you want to do. And if you listen to everyone, you'll never fucking be happy because no one's ever going to be happy, dude.
Yeah.
You know, I listen to everyone on Twitch, on my stream, that told me what to do, and like, oh, your mic's too loud, or your music's too low, no, no, no. Every person has a different opinion, so they just gotta adjust their volume, and that's it. You just do what you do, and then they'll adjust to you.
Unless it's an eggplant, then you gotta adjust a little bit.
Well, you should've just told them it's a fruit, and then they would've been, the whole mind of the eggplant would've changed, because they would've been on the topic of eggplants being fruits.
Yeah.
You didn't know an eggplant was a fruit?
I didn't. Like, you know, how does that change the dick?
You know, olives are fruits?
No.
Yeah.
Damn.
And peppers, like jalapeno is a fruit, and like all the peppers are fruits also.
Is a potato a fruit? That's a vegetable.
Potato's not a fruit. There's no seeds inside of a potato.
Oh, it's got a seeds
inside of it. Yeah. So anything that has a seed inside of it is technically a fruit. Mm. Classified as a fruit. So,
yo.
Yeah.
Have you seen Exotic Fruit Company?
Yeah.
It's like one of my friend's companies, but like the exotic fruits are fucking crazy. Like all the different colors and shit, mm-hmm. like the pink pineapples and like all this shit that you wouldn't even know are fruits or fruits. So like,
Yeah, there's a lot of fruits that, like, avocados are fruits, and you know, bananas are berry, banana berry.
What?
Yeah, dude. There is so many, dog. I got blown. Beans are considered a fruit, like green beans.
Damn.
Yeah, dog. It blew my mind, bro. So, what do you like smoking? What is a day in the life of Harrison? What does it consist of now? What are we doing? Are we waking up?
Yeah, usually I like wake up and be like, oh shit. And
what
do I do?
Wait, what do you mean? You wake up, oh shit. It's another day, I'm here. Let's do something.
But it's like, there's a lot of I think there's a lot of pressure on me that I'm putting on myself, maybe unnecessarily, to like get the comedy thing to work and be good at it. And it's like, I've been doing the Daily High Club for a while, and I feel like I've been like, we've been pretty on top of our game for a while, and it's like I'm starting this thing at the ground floor. It just psychologically gets to me that it's like I'm not like making money right now. Like, I've definitely done well. It's just like to know that I'm not like
there's
like,
no current
providing
income.
Value for society in any way. I'm just like chilling and trying to make up jokes, and like I've actually been doing a lot of like just like shit lately. Like today I so the office that I had, the Daily High Club office, I had like just taken my file cabinets and all my shit and just put it in my trunk. That was like almost a year ago, and I've just been driving around with my entire office
in
my
trunk
for like a year, and like people didn't know. It's just like every fucking event that I went to or whatever, like thank God no one like broke in my car, because my whole office was in there, like every fucking thing, the phones, the computers.
You just don't want to take it out and put it in your house?
I had no room in my place, so I just got like a storage thing and moved it out, and I just got health insurance, so like I haven't been like completely chilling yet. I'm still like just doing shit.
Adulting.
I have to like adulting, yeah. But pretty soon I'm gonna be at the point where I'll like actually have like a truly open schedule, which will be pretty crazy, and I'm sure I'll wanna do something again soon.
Are you writing every day? Like, what is?
Yeah. So
is that like you wake up and you're like, oh shit, I'm here, let me plug in, and then you just start writing thoughts, or is it like a process? Do you, like, what is your process to write?
Yeah, I'll usually just like, I don't know. I like think of things throughout the day and write it down. It's like I'll usually just go on Reddit or like.
So it's not like a time thing. You're not like dedicating to like, all right, the next 2 hours I'm gonna sit.
Sometimes I try to like, but it doesn't always work. I feel like the best ideas sometimes just come randomly when you're
in the shower and you have no way to write it down.
Yeah.
You're fucking taking a shit.
Dude, a lot of good ideas in the shower.
Yeah. I feel like my brain works active in the bathroom when I'm shitting and showering. I was like, that's a great idea. And then I forget about it.
Yeah.
But I knew it was great.
Isn't it that Mitch Hedberg joke about
cannabis?
I don't remember the joke, so I probably should say it. But it's something about, like, yeah, I don't remember it. But it was about writing down your jokes. It was funny. Yeah.
And there's a lot of people that tell me, like, you just need to write shit down. Because I never write anything down at all. But I feel like there's some witty things that have been said, and I just never remember them because I'm always witty. I'm litty when I'm witty.
I always try to write funny shit down. It's like even throughout Daily High Club, like I have a not really journal, but just like this list of all things that have happened that are just like completely out of the ordinary things that I like want to remember happen. So.
Yeah,
and I'm sure you've been in tons of those situations yourself.
Yeah, I just wish I got to write down, what, like a journal or diary? What are they calling these days? I mean, like, I used to be able to look at my life through social media and be like, oh, yeah, I looked like 3 months ago and remember what I did, because it was like a vlog, you know? It was like a fucking journal, a live journal of my life. And here's pictures and moments, and here's what I ate, and here's where I was. But, you know, they just say, you know what, we don't want you to have an account anymore. Yeah. They take you away. You're like, damn, what about all my pictures and my messages? And you're like, all right, I'll just start again. And then you do it again, and then it happens again, and then it happens again. And then you're just like, you know what, fuck this shit. I'm over it.
Yeah, it was definitely one of the biggest. Actually, I can confidently say it was the biggest stressor in my life for the last 7 years. Is getting my shit deleted, because it's like, if we got Daily High Club deleted, then it's like 20 to 40 people lose their fucking jobs, like, pretty much immediately, like, if we can't get it back. Fortunately, we've been able to get it back, but sometimes you can't get it back, and it's just like, no one knows what the fuck is going on and why they enforce it against, like, just some people who post weed and bongs all day who have no problem. And fortunately, we've a lot of it's just been luck, but it's just like every day I was like, I'd have literally nightmares. I'd wake up and the next day I lose everything I've been working for.
And that's crazy that we have that mentality where, like, Instagram is, what, like a decade? How long has it been around? Like a decade, maybe a dozen years, if that. And how people's life has just got so involved with it, and that has become like their everything. And I know people that have like gone like mental breakdowns, and I know people that made a, you know, lost their lives because of social media and things that happen on there, and their accounts getting taken away. And it's just, that's why I love real life experiences. That's why I'm like, yo, you can see me in real life. Like, social media is cool, but it has become like a necessary evil that we have, because like everyone's like, oh, you going to this event, or you going to that event, or you pull out. I was like, bro, I don't have social media right now to see all these flyers. Can we just communicate like the old days? If you really want to see me, hey Adam, how you doing? I'm doing this on today. Would really love to see you. Pull up.
Yeah.
Here's my invitation or flyer. But now it's like, I posted this shit, bitch. I expect you to see it. If you don't see it, fuck you. You don't care about me. Well, you know what? Cool. Bye. Yeah. I don't care.
I'll just write you like a handwritten invitation or send a fucking dove with the
I'll give you my address. Send me a letter here in the mail. RSVP.
Yeah. I'll send a bird.
Send the pigeon.
Yeah.
I'm reading that shit. You got to chill with Tyson too, yeah?
No, I actually have never met him.
Oh, what? I thought you guys did a whole... No?
No.
Okay. Because I know you've been with a lot of people, dude.
Yeah. I was actually supposed to go to Tyson Ranch one weekend, and I ended up not being able to go. I think I got sick or something, but I remember it was like the opportunity was there to go, and there's like a decent chance I would have met him there, but I ended up not making it. I was like flying back from another trip, and I just felt like shit, and his place is like in the desert, and I'm just like, I would have had to like get like right off the plane. I think it might have been like Birthright. It was like a 20-hour flight, and then like immediately I would have to leave LAX.
You did Birthright?
Yeah.
When? How long ago?
I did it in 2017, which was a mistake.
Why?
It wasn't a mistake to do it. It was a mistake that like I was just buried in fucking emergencies for work. Like I was on Masada, the mountain, and like our payment processor went down, and we're like screaming into the phone trying to figure it out
on the mountain by the Dead
on the
sea
mountain,
the
it's like fucking sunset, everyone's in like a peaceful moment,
and you're like, what the fuck do you mean?
And like, it's like our subscriptions were supposed to renew, and they're like mass failing in real time, and it's like we're potentially never gonna get those, like those people are gonna not get their boxes and stuff. It's just like, it was such a nightmare, and it was like shit got like seized, and it was like I was overseas and trying to deal with it in a different time zone. I was like wake up in the middle of the fucking night all night, and like I was just like so tied to the business at that point.
Oh my god.
Like I loved going there, but I wasn't able to experience.
Was that your only time?
Yeah, and then they're like, we had like a logistical error, so we're like skipping Tel Aviv and going to Ashkenaz or something.
Ashkelon.
Ashkelon, yeah.
That's like where King David, like his old fortress is on the beach and shit.
Yeah, so we went to Tel Aviv for like 3 hours, but I feel like I missed out, so maybe one day.
Let's go back. Let's go.
It's
we'll do a little trip.
Beautiful country for sure.
For those wondering what Birthright is a free trip that you get. If you are born Jewish, you could claim these free tickets to go visit Israel between the ages of like 18 to 25 or something, I think it is, or 27. And they take you to like most of the main points of Israel. And it's like a fucked up schedule. They wake you up at like 5 a.m. and then they put you to bed at like 10 p.m. or some shit. And you're like with a group of other people from around the country. And it's a cool experience, but they have you on a tight schedule. So I can only imagine you dealing with like business shit while going on these like super tight scheduled events and shit.
Yeah, so that was the gist of it. But yeah, Israel, definitely want to go back. I won't say I agree with their government, and I won't say that I'm very religious, but as a place, it's beautiful.
No, it's like a historical place. I mean, we hear the stories all the time. The Bible talks about a lot of places that happened in that, in the like Jerusalem and
the birth of three religions.
Yeah. And you're in there. If you go to Jerusalem, you see where the it's like the Muslim quarters, it's the Jewish quarters, and you got the Catholic quarters, and Jesus is buried there, and the Virgin Mary is buried there, and it's just like you feel the energy, and it's just the history. It's just a crazy place, and the food is delicious. I love Mediterranean food.
Yeah, it's like the best.
It's fresh, food. And the beaches are wonderful, and, you know, it's just a crazy place.
Yeah, it was just like, yo, we're going to fly you out for free to the other side of the world, and you'll get to see a bunch of cool shit, and get a bunch of free schnitzel and cucumbers and tomatoes and
falafel.
Shit. And falafel for free. Yeah. It's like, how could you say no? It's like, I was getting too old to do it. My parents wouldn't let me do it growing up.
No, I'm just kidding. Your parents are probably lovely people. They are. Well, yeah, I tell anyone, like, it's a free trip, dude. It's a free trip. It's a free trip to the country, and they take you to all the tourist locations, and it's good to take notes, so when you go back in the future, you can be like, all right, I want to go here again, here again, here again, here again. Yeah.
But it was cool, man. It's like the birth of three different religions. Just so many people in the world have been inspired in different ways by, like, this one spot. But,
yeah. And you feel, like, I go off a lot of like energy and vibes, and like I feel that shit. And when you go to certain places, I'm sure when you walk into certain rooms, you'll feel like something like, yo, I got a bad feeling about this, or I feel, oh, it feels good, the energy in here is good. When you walk into like the old city, when you're in the, you just feel like, it just feels like ancient. There's so much shit that's happened. You just feel this, just like, I don't know what that energy is, dude, but it's just crazy, and just it's like indescribable. Yeah. And when you go to certain places, you see how certain people react to it, and it hits certain people differently. You're like, dude, what is the energy going on here? It's crazy.
Yeah.
Yeah, dude. What? Yeah. I'll tell you what, Harrison, do you smoke daily? Are you a daily absolutely. High guy?
Yeah.
What's your absolutely. Preferred smoking?
Absolutely. So I feel like people are going to judge me for this. But,
no one's judging.
I've had three sinus surgeries, so on my own, I don't smoke as much anymore. But I'm all about the vapes and edibles. I'm like, I've really been into edible drinks lately. I'd never seen this one before. Yeah, it's just like such a chill way to get high. It's just like feels a little cleaner for me, but there's nothing like the feeling of smoking. Like when I'm out with people and on the weekends I do it, but like when I'm alone, like usually I'll like go for the volcano or like the edibles.
So you flower vape?
Yeah.
Flower vape. And then, I mean that...
I've had the volcano fucking forever. Yeah. And I was like, yeah.
The drinks, they're cool. Like edibles are cool. They hit me really hard. I get really affected by edibles, and drinks usually hit me quicker because of that nanotech, and it just goes through your bloodstream faster. So I could see you enjoying that. But do you like the flavors of the edibles now? Because I know in California it's like max at what, 100 milligrams per serving.
I just got back from Canada. It's 10. It's like
10 milligrams.
10, yeah.
That's like nothing
per package.
So it's like 20 gummies, and it's like 10 milligrams of each gummy is like 0.05.
Yeah. Fucked up.
At least you can eat a whole bag and not feel worried. Because that's the shit that I worry about sometimes is, all right, I'm going to eat this. It says 1,000 milligrams or 500 milligrams, whatever. So I'll take a little piece and I'll eat it. I'm like, oh, this is pretty good. And I take another piece and I'm eating it. And then before I know it, the whole thing is gone. Yeah. I'm like, yo, I just wanted to eat some snacks. I had the munchies, and now I'm going to be high as fuck for the next 6 hours.
Yeah.
Have
you ever been high for multiple, like, more than 2 days from edibles? Or, like gone into an edible coma?
So, like, I've woken up the next day with like that weed hangover, yeah, or weed, whatever it is, where it's just groggy and I can't focus and I'm super sluggish and I feel like I'm still high, and like I've had that linger.
Yeah.
But then, like, once the day starts, I have ADD and shit, and I just start smoking some weed, drink my Red Bull. I'm like, all right, let's go.
Yeah, hell yeah.
And then I just crash hard again.
Yeah.
Yeah. What about you?
Yeah, I once just, like, took so many edibles that I slept for 2 days from Friday to Sunday, and I just, like, I remember just trying to, like, every muscle in my body, like, I tried so hard to move, and I, like, couldn't move. I was, like, it felt like a K-hole. Like, I was just, like, stuck in my own body. It wasn't, like, painful. It was just, like, I'm, like, incapacitated and cannot move. It was, like, it was a little scary, but it was, like, I wasn't gonna die. Like, I knew I wasn't gonna die. I'm just, like, I just gotta ride it the fuck
out. Damn, 2 days. That's a long time, dude, to be high.
So, it was at my friend's bachelor party. He's an English teacher, high school English teacher, and someone made edibles, and we just, like, made a fuck ton for the whole weekend, and we ate them all that night, and two people went to the ER. One of them was an EMT, so...
just got too high, didn't it feel?
Everyone just got too high, and, like, people were freaking out and passing out, and I slept from Friday to Sunday. I missed the entire thing. I missed both people going to the hospital. Oh. It was just like... holy shit, like, edibles are real, because that was, like, my first time ever, like, going balls deep into edibles, just like, oh, I can eat all I want, and, like, we'll see what happens, like, probably nothing, but it was, like, it could fuck you up.
Yeah.
Yeah,
you can oversaturate your endocannabinoid receptors and consume too much where your body will react. I've gotten into crazy stages, too, of, like, you know, high anxiety, like, I felt I was physically present, but I was super disengaged, where, like, yes, mentally I couldn't really conversate, and I was just, like, in my head super fucked because of being way too high and just having this negative effect on my whatever, my cognitive, my memory, speaking ability, my, it was just fucked up. And I was like, yo, this is, I can't do this anymore.
Yeah.
Yeah, and then you get, like, I had, like, super anxiety from it sometimes, where you just overconsume and just trigger some things. I don't know what it is, dude, but... at least we're good now, baby. Yeah, we just breeze through it, baby. We go on hikes and we exercise.
Yeah.
You be hiking all the time.
Yeah.
Is that your, like...
yeah, I try to go every day or two.
Is that like exercise? Is that your form of exercise, or do you other things?
I run and I lift too, but I'm like, yeah, I also, like, feel like I don't eat as healthy as I should, though. But
none of us do.
I'm decent about exercising.
Yeah, dude, because I be seeing you, and I'm like, this fool's just, like, hitting every single trail that's available, and then you, like, traveling the world, and you're like, all right, I'm going to go to this trail. Oh, I'm in Australia. Let me go on this trail. Maybe I'll see some kangaroos. Yeah.
I just found out I probably can't go back to Australia.
What do you mean?
Because I got $800 in speeding tickets.
What?
Yeah.
Like, they pulled you over? Is on
no,
camera?
No, it's, like, camera. And it's only 2 miles per hour over there is the limit. So it's like everything's in kilometers, though, and I'm like confused as fuck. And I guess I just, like, got a bunch of those tickets, and so I need to either pay them or maybe not be allowed to go back.
So it's $800 in speeding tickets, and you didn't know?
800 Australian, which is like 500 US.
And you didn't know about the...
I had no idea until, like, pretty recently.
They sent it in the mail?
Yeah.
Oh, that's international for them too, so, you know, that costs them money.
Yeah.
Do you want to go back to Australia?
Yeah, but I'll figure it out. I'm hoping they'll forget about it. Like, it'll be a while. Don't they go away after like 7 years or something?
I don't know their laws over there.
Yeah.
But I remember, because when you were in Australia, I thought it was because of the video you posted that went viral and had a whole bunch of people talking shit.
Oh, yeah, there's that too. Yeah.
I was like, oh, I'm not allowed in Australia. Yeah, they saw my video and they're like, yeah, fuck this fool. He ain't coming anywhere.
There's a. Did you see that Daily Mail article?
Uh-uh.
Yeah, there's a Daily Mail article about my video.
What? What did that happen? So let people know what happened with your video, because I know you tried to, like, you were comparing it to America.
Yeah, I made this video. Essentially, I was comparing it to America, and some people got really pissed that I compared it to America. But, like, most people did not get pissed, which is why the video did really well, and,
What did Daily Mail say?
So, they also, for the record, in the article, it says America is a shitty desert crack hole. So, that is some bullshit.
So, they just embellished on it.
Yeah. They're just, like, trying to start shit.
Yeah. They were just clickbaiting.
Yeah.
So, you were just So just to paint the picture, if no one understands, Harrison went to Australia. He basically, yo, listen, dude, this fool was like, you know what, I'm going to travel. He bought like a $12 ticket to Hawaii, then found a $10 ticket to Australia. He's like, yo, I'm out. I got shit to do. I'm fun employed right now. Daily High Club's in the hands of someone else. We chilling, baby. He's in Australia. He's walking around, checking out the city. He sees like a Taco Bell, a KFC, a Subway, a McDonald's, like every single fast food chain that we have here on one corner. And he's all like, oh, look, America in Australia or something. Like basic like yeah. that. And the internet went nuts over it. They like commented, got so many views. You said Daily Mail twisted your words and call it. And I'm like, yo, this fool just, and it's like that everywhere. Like you go any Israel, yeah. I went to some intersection and it's all American yeah. brands. I go on Google Earth, I travel the world, I see American companies everywhere.
It's internet. Interesting. It's like there's no fucking Kentucky near here and there's Kentucky fried chicken.
Yeah. Yeah. Yeah, like how do they know what KFC is? But I'm sure we have restaurants here that have probably started in other countries that we don't know about because we're not from those countries.
Yeah.
So it's like, oh, I don't know. And then when I'm in this country, oh, I'm like, oh, that's where it's, oh, Aroma. Okay, I see what it is, dude. But,
it's actually just an Instagram story, and, like, one of my friends, his girlfriend from Australia, and was like, yo, you should post that on TikTok, and then just, like, blew up.
What? And you did it?
Yeah.
TikTok, you on TikTok a lot?
I go in waves. Okay. Like, I do it, and then I get really discouraged, because something will suck, and then I'll stop for, like, 2 months, and then go back to it.
Okay, yeah. Everyone's be like, you should get on it. I'm like, bro, TikTok just be deleting all my videos, even when I don't have smoke. I feel like my face is just
blocked. Dude, they're brutal. They delete so much shit.
Whatever. We love... It's China, right? We get our rigs from there, we get our platforms from there.
Yeah. So they should let us post our rigs.
Harrison, look, I feel like we keep going. I'm getting the wrap it up signal, dude.
All right.
You're coming in saying wrap it up. I feel like we're just barely starting getting to know Harrison out here, dude. What's your socials? It's where people can find you. If people want to see more about you. You got comedy shows coming up. Do all the plugs.
Yeah. So my Instagram is HiCEO. My TikTok is HiCEO.
Which is a great name, by the way.
Oh, thank you. Yeah, no one had it.
Yeah.
And my Twitter... Oh, fuck, what's my Twitter?
It's not your name.
It's Harrison Baum. Yeah.
I found that because I tagged you today.
Yeah, hell yeah. Thank you.
Yeah. Harrison Baum here. If you got a Daily High Club box, this is the man who helped you get it. Is making it happen. Check his comedy out. He will be touring in a city near you. He got shows happening. You can see his jokes on his socials. Just chilling out. Kyntron, how you feeling, dude?
Chilling in the California love right now.
Yeah, you've been playing. I don't know if you've been playing for the past 30 minutes, but I'm hearing
I'm just stuck in the zone right now. I'm trying to get all the parts down, you know?
Dude, I love the piano. The keyboard. The keyboard. So sick.
He's available. You can hire him for your sets, dude.
You should, man.
He can play in the background, dude. You can do all the tracks, dude. Listen, shout out to Harrison coming through.
Thank you for having me.
Nah, dude, it's a long time wait. We're gonna get you back, though. I feel like there's a lot more to talk about. We just learned the basics. We need to know who Harrison is now, dude. Do you believe in aliens, dog? Do you eat sushi?
Yes,
what's your favorite color? You know what I'm saying? Great. There's a whole lot to talk about.
Yeah.
shout out to everyone listening. I appreciate you. Y'all could be anywhere in the world doing whatever you want, and you here with us listening to this or watching this. We appreciate you. And a real big, huge shout out to all the growers out there, every single grower. I don't give a fuck if it's one plant or 1,000 plants, indoor, outdoor, basement, tent, closet. Without you guys, none of us would be smoking. Without you guys, we wouldn't have these lifestyles. So we appreciate you guys. Once again, my name is Adam Hill, the highest host. This is the podcast here on Haze Radio. Until next time, I'll see you. Okay. Bye.
Adios.
You're the best, Harrison. Yeah.